Seats benefit the reclaiming community. For more info, including where to get tickets, visit www.reclaiming.org/rituals/sawin.html.
And you are listening to KPFA in Berkeley, KPFB in Berkeley, and KFCF in Fresno. The time is 1:30. Stay tuned next for Making Contact.
This week on Making Contact.
I believe today the church needs to have a message that civil leadership and politicians can grab a hold of and say, these people are giving us some hope. These people have some solutions to society's problems.
You can't just believe that Jesus is your savior. You have to act like it.
Given all the natural and man-made disasters of biblical proportions just in the first half of this decade, a lot of people are saying a lot of prayers. In the United States, it so happens that most of those praying are Christians. Even if you're not a Christian, but you still care about the fate of the planet, it's worth understanding how the power of faith shapes society's attitudes and behaviors.
On this special edition, the first of two programs on the left, right, and Christian, we journey through the reddest county in the nation, Orange County, California.
I'm Justin Beck.
And I'm Pauline Bartoloni. We're your hosts this week on Making Contact, a program creating connections between people, vital ideas, and important information.
It's an early Sunday morning at the Grove of Anaheim, a popular concert venue just across the vast parking lot of the Angels baseball stadium. In a few hours, the New York Yankees will beat the local team, known officially as the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim. But right now, under purple lights and giant video screens, about 100 Southern Californians of all ages have come for more than just entertainment. Swaying back and forth, their hands raised high in the air, they proudly sing the mission of the day.
What did you come to do, kids?
Praise the Lord!
I want to hear. What did you come to do? All right. Now I've got to feel that faith of yours.
The preacher is Wendy McDonald, an evangelist and co-founder of Healing Word International. She and her husband came from South Africa to take over Healing Word in the mid-1990s. This church boasts more than 1,500 members, who are based mainly in California. And the church says those numbers keep growing. It's not unusual for 500 people to attend a Sunday service. The church has outreach ministries spanning parking lots, parks, and local shopping malls. Its mission? Win people to Jesus. During this service, a youth chorus sings backup to preachers like Wendy, who make sure to keep her followers entertained and moved by God. The two-hour Sunday event includes a dance troupe, an awards ceremony for young leaders, and a short film about Christian youth camp. The dress code is Southern California casual.
You have those gospel shoes on, the shoes of peace. You're going to tread everything under your feet because the peace of God rules and reigns in your heart. There might be a storm on the outside, but on the inside, you'll not be shaken because the peace of God rules and reigns. Amen. And then the Bible says the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost.
Wendy McDonald and the members of Healing Word call themselves Charismatics, a loosely defined branch of Christian faith that began in the U.S. during the 1960s and is closely related to the Pentecostal movement. Charismatics believe worship and music can put them in direct contact with the Spirit of God or Holy Spirit. Many Charismatics attend service because they have something to heal. Through prayer and speaking in tongues, these non-denominational Christians get the positive reinforcement they need to carry out God's work throughout the week. And like some Christians, they believe that the end of the world is coming soon.
You know, the Bible says that in the last days everything that can be shaken will be shaken.
Yes.
And the only thing that remains is what? The kingdom of God. Sir, if you're undergoing a little shaking on the inside, remember, the only thing that remains is the righteousness of God.
Yes.
You're right before Him today.
Hallelujah.
Just as though you never sinned. That's the kind of way He sees you. Tell the person next to you, I'm righteous. Just as though I never sinned. And then tell the person next to you, I have peace. That means nothing can shake you.
The purpose is to grow from glory to glory to glory. The purpose of the church is to get stronger and stronger. The purpose of the church is to be relevant to this generation. The purpose of the church is for us to make a change in the society in which we live in right now.
The uniqueness of our church has always been that we're a place of healing and hope. And so we see that God is the overall healer. He heals broken hearts, lives, marriages. We really say that God is a healer, that He can heal people out of any situation in life.
That's Wendy's husband, Pastor Neville McDonald. After the service, we sat down with Neville to get to the core values of the charismatic movement.
The message of faith that we see in the life of the disciples all throughout the scripture was that believers had an impact on their society to change the destiny of men, the history of men. You cannot read through the Old Testament without noticing that prophets changed the destiny of kings. That doesn't mean we have to walk around in sackcloth and act crazy, but it simply means that the prophets had a message that impacted the leadership, the civil leadership of the day. And I believe today the church needs to have a message that civil leadership and politicians can grab a hold of and say, these people are giving us some hope. These people have some solutions to society's problems. So our mindset shouldn't be an irresponsible one of, get me out of here, Jesus. Our mindset should be, how can I fix things in my society? And so I see that anyone who will yield to the Spirit of God can be used by the Spirit of God. And so it's just an attitude of, do I want God to use me or not? Will I be obedient or not obedient? And then flow in that obedience and do what He wants us to do.
There's nothing like God's presence.
Amen.
There's nothing like being in worship. The Bible.
Among the obedient worshipers at Healing Word this Sunday is Lupe Moreno. She lives in Santa Ana, a largely Latino community just a few miles south of here. During the service, Lupe shouts amen and participates in faith healing with a group of teenagers. We met Lupe two nights earlier at the Orange County Fairgrounds, where she was tabling for the Republican Party. We'll hear from Lupe a little later on. While it's no Disneyland, the Orange County Fairgrounds could easily rival the Magic Kingdom as one of the happiest places on Earth. Funnel cakes, Ferris wheels, haunted houses, carnival games, and very little visible security. Couples holding hands, the majority of them young people of color. And aside from the strong aroma of elephant dung, the fairgrounds are a pretty welcoming place. On my way to finding Lupe Moreno at the Republican Party table, I'm approached a number of times by random people drawn to my microphone. And as I soon find out, they're just as up for a political debate as they are for a ride in a bumper car. Take George and Louise Giacope, a couple of middle-aged liberals tabling for the Democratic Party.
There are about 425,000 Democrats in Orange County, which may seem like a high number, but it's a lower number than the Republicans in Orange County, which is a pretty conservative area.
Do you belong to a church?
Yeah, we belong to an organized church. We're both Roman Catholic, and you know, we see that as important in our lives, although I don't think it drives our politics. I think it's a personal kind of thing, and it's a personal commitment. I don't see it as a religious issue within politics. I just see that as a separate item.
So are you concerned at all about the rise of the religious right here in the United States?
Yes.
And why?
Because I sincerely, with all my heart, believe in the separation of church and state, and I see that eroding, and I don't want that to happen. I think church is church and state is state, and they should not be mixed.
As we talk, I notice a man off to the side taking our picture and sarcastically yelling, "Blame Bush." He says his name is Mark Samietz and that he's both a Republican and a Christian. I ask Mark if he supports George Bush and the war in Iraq.
Absolutely, it's about leadership. Do you know he has a higher GPA than John Kerry did at Yale?
So what? He also went AWOL when John Kerry didn't. Tit for tat.
John Kerry also shot Vietnamese with a 50 caliber, which is against the Geneva Convention.
We were just talking about it.
Convention? Tell me about Guantanamo and Abu Ghraib. Tell me about the Geneva Convention there, please.
Okay, if you're familiar with operations other than warfare and terrorist operations, okay, do you think that using humans in a missile at 300 passenger planes in the buildings is considered fair?
You didn't answer my question. I asked you about Guantanamo and Abu Ghraib.
Right.
Answer that question.
Right. When Osama bin Laden attacked our country to stay safe and preserve our freedom.
Why didn't we go after bin Laden?
We've been going after bin Laden.
We haven't.
I fought in Afghanistan. I know we're going there.
We didn't put artillery in Afghanistan.
I'm an artillery officer.
Oh, really? Tell me more about your military experience.
I was in the Army for 8 years, and I was a reserve officer also. I fought with the 155 howitzers. Okay.
When did you go in?
I got in originally.
A year later.
I got in originally 91 for the first Gulf War.
As Mark argues with George and Louise, I remind them that they're all Christians. And before I know it, both sides in the debate are shaking hands. I ask them how it's possible they could all share the same faith, but disagree so strongly on politics.
It's the same difference that my fiance is a female and I'm a male. It's God's will. And I think the reason why God created Democrats and Republicans simplistically is to foster communication and not always agree. But in fostering communication, lines of communication are open, and that's what he wants. So we can support God's will. Because if we're not talking to one another, his will never be fulfilled.
I don't think it has anything to do with God. I think it's, you know, our individual choices. That's one thing that God did give us was the ability to make choices. He gave us all free will, each of us free will. And it's up to us to do something with it.
We can either do it right or screw it up.
Indoors, away from the fluffy clouds of cotton candy and gut-churning carnival rides, we finally meet up with Lupe Moreno, one of the members of the Healing Word International Church. Besides being a devout, charismatic Christian, she's also a political activist, deeply devoted to volunteering for conservative causes. Making Contact's Megan Kaiser picks up the story here.
On Friday nights at the county fair, Lupe Moreno splits her time between registering new voters and passing out crayons and drawings of famous politicians for children to color. She has caricatures of George Bush, Ronald Reagan, and Abraham Lincoln, but she says Arnold Schwarzenegger is the most popular with the kids.
I just finished being the secretary of the Orange County Republican Party, so my term was up in January. I am a delegate for the 69th Assembly District in the state of California, so I do go up to Sacramento, and I am also president of the Santa Ana Republican Women. And I'm also president of Latino Americans for Immigration Reform. I feel that illegal immigration is a very big problem in the state of California. We have to do something about it, and I do a couple of other things.
Lupe's father was a coyote, someone who brings immigrants from Mexico into the U.S. to find work and a place to live. Lupe says the undocumented immigrants who came into her home sexually abused her repeatedly, causing her considerable grief later in life. After her father passed away, Lupe dedicated her life to stopping illegal immigration, not because of her abuse, she says, but for political reasons. She says those who cross the border illegally are rationalizing sin because they take jobs, health care, and services away from American citizens. She likes to quote from the Bible, "Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's belongings." As part of her activism, Lupe makes colorful posters and signs that she takes with her to rallies and protests.
Mexico fails its citizens. I made this poster up because I feel that the country of Mexico does not take care of its citizens. And if it did take care of its citizens wouldn't be over here illegally. So that's what that one says. And this one is for our country, for our president actually secure our borders.
But Lupe does more than just make posters. She volunteers for the Minutemen, the controversial grassroots border patrol that has sprung up to stop the flow of immigrants into the U.S. Lupe says she had a close call the previous weekend camping out at the U.S.-Mexico border.
We're not supposed to have any contact with any people that we see coming in legally. We're actually supposed to call the Border Patrol, tell them we see something, and then they're supposed to take care of it. So all we do is get lawn chairs. We got our lawn chairs out. It was kind of getting dark, so we didn't have the binoculars out, but we had flashlights and all that kind of stuff. We were just talking, and all of a sudden, out of the dark, we were in a gully, and way up on top of the hill, somebody started shining a bright light on us. Then they started playing Mexican music, and they were screaming down to us in Spanish. First, they welcome to Mexico, you know, our land, and then they started threatening us. And they come with, I guess, semi-matic weapons and stuff. And so the man told me to get in the car. Well, when I got in the car, I have a new car, and all the lights turned on, and I didn't know how to turn off the lights. So I was sitting there scared that I was going to get shot. So I started praying. I was praying. And one of my friends chased him away, chased the people away. But they kept coming back during the night. We didn't sleep. We didn't sleep because they kept coming back all night and playing loud music. And that's when I called my daughters. I said, you know what? I don't know what kind of situation I've gotten myself into. I said, please start praying for me, praying for all of us because, you know, I don't know what's going on. They kept saying, we're going to go get you. Tell us where you are. We're going to go get you. And I said, you can't go get me. Just pray for me. And so the rest of the night, we just stayed awake until 5 o'clock in the morning. And that's when the men, I guess, figured that these people were asleep, and we all caravanned out.
Lupe spent the first 10 years of her life in Cottonwood, a small town in Northern California where she says she learned everything she needed in life. Her mother worked 3 jobs and took care of the family, but left after Lupe's father refused to give up bringing people across the border. Lupe says she's always known the difference between right and wrong. Since she left the Catholic Church and became a charismatic, Lupe says she has dealt with that part of her life, and she sees the immigration issue as her calling from a higher authority. In Orange County, more than 30% of the population is Latino, the majority Catholic. And in Santa Ana, where Lupe lives today, 2/3 of Latino adults are not U.S. citizens. Some are legal residents, but many are not. As the daughter of a Texas woman and a Mexican immigrant, Lupe has become the poster child for immigration reform. Her ongoing battle has conservatives patting her on the back and highlighting her ethnicity to further their cause. At the same time, many in the Latino community say she's racist. After first meeting her at the fairgrounds, we stopped by Lupe's home to continue our conversation with her. 4th of July is long past, but Lupe proudly displays lots of red, white, and blue in front of her house. An American flag flies above the door. Underneath is an American flag wind chime. There's an American flag sticker in the living room window. Next to the sidewalk are red, white, and blue spray-painted flowers. And as you walk inside past a statuette of an angel, you're greeted by a heart-shaped American flag and a sign saying welcome. We asked Lupe what motivates her to go so far as to support the Minutemen against illegal immigration.
Isn't life funny? I have come from being a married woman that was always married, seems like forever, to the man that I just absolutely adored. I was a Democrat and I was a Catholic, and I'm divorced. I'm a Republican, and I'm against illegal immigration. But life is funny, and I think God just took me in another direction. I never thought I was going to go to the border, never. And as the time got closer, I don't know, God just put in my heart that to go out there. So the Republican Party basically is supposed to stand for, you know, standing for righteousness. Actually, that's what one of the little things that I started joking about is that the Republicans are on the right side of God, at least that we're supposed to be. You know, we're supposed to be above the fray. And this is one of the things I like about being Republican. I mean, I love God. I absolutely love God. I grew up around nuns and I grew up around priests. And, you know, I grew up with the nuns telling us, you know, you're not supposed to lie. You're not supposed to do this. You're not supposed to do that. And then I had a very hard mother, too, that said the same thing to us. And then I went to school and they said the same thing to us. Love of country, love of God, you know, love of family. And that's the way I grew up. Spent with you.
You're listening to Making Contact, a production of the National Radio Project. If you'd like more information, or for cassette or CD copies of this program, please call 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also visit our website at radioproject.org.
Not all churchgoers in Orange County say keeping immigrants out of the U.S. is doing God's work. Just across town in working-class Santa Ana, Dwight Smith wakes up every day to more than 100 of the city's homeless under his own roof.
Everybody vertical in their own way. Rise up and meet the morning, even the rest of the whole day.
This is Dwight's version of a wake-up call to the dozens of people strewn across his hardwood floors every morning. His house is a makeshift shelter, with every inch occupied by sleeping people and their belongings. Many more sleep in his backyard, some with only a thin sheet cushioning them from the cold concrete.
I wake up before 6:30 because that's when I'm supposed to sing the vertical song.
Everybody vertical in their own way.
And all I want people to do is sit up in bed and make some part of their body vertical, because they're going to still sleep. So will I. We'll sleep through anything, right? And it'll be 9 o'clock, and they'll finally get out of bed, and we'll be trying to, you know, make a 300-person meal, and they'll be in the way. Plus, the kids should be in school.
I go back today, and if it's not better, I go in the hospital.
Okay.
They have me 2 kinds of antibiotics.
Before long, Dwight is surrounded by people with papers to sign or injuries that need tending to. He's prepared to meet their demands with kind words or a full tank of gas. The women, children, and working poor who stay at the shelter simply call it Dwight's Place. But its formal name is Isaiah House, homeless shelter by night and soup kitchen by day. Dwight's sense of humor is almost as persistent as the chaos, the noise, and the clutter of Isaiah House. But he says it's all part of doing God's work.
It's like I'm taking 100 glasses of water to poor firemen, right, who just beat back a blaze, and they're exhausted, and I drop 5 glasses. And everyone focuses on the puddle on the floor. My God, there's a puddle on the floor. Well, yeah, but there's 95 firemen that got a drink. What's the problem? These people are the fire people of Christianity, because they're the ones who suffer for our redemption. They're the ones who go into the flames, right, of indifference, of cruelty, and they suffer, and then they come home at night, and we take out 100 cups of water, and we spill 5.
Dwight wasn't always a self-described vessel for Christ. He converted to Catholicism 8 years ago when he took over the shelter with his wife, Leah. Before that, he'd spent most of his life working for corporate America and only became religious when he was helping his sister-in-law find a date by shopping around at local churches.
I didn't know anything about religion. I'd read part of the Bible one time, but it was actually a book of stories from the Bible for young people, you know, and it was ridiculous. And I thought it was ridiculous. I was kind of a Unitarian, you know, in high school. And that was an interesting place. We went to Divinaville Pines. It was a place up in the mountains with our little group from San Diego. And Ken Kesey and the Merry Pranksters came by in their bus and gave us all acid. What an amazing little church youth retreat, you know. And we dug all these holes in the snow looking for a pound of dope. It was terrible. And my car broke. The linkage froze on my Volvo. You'd think a Volvo would work in the snow, but it didn't. And we had to dig the car out of the snow. And it's terrible. So being a Unitarian was a lot more adventuresome than being a Catholic.
Now, at the age of 54, Dwight could be seen driving around town in his white van, preaching the word of Jesus Christ.
This country experiences quadrennial bouts of irreligious behavior when they elect somebody. I mean, it's kind of a travesty, because we always have Christians who agree not to imitate Christ. Yeah. Okay, well, I'll continue military funding, and I'll continue dropping bombs, and, you know, but I'm a Christian. I want you to know I'm a Christian, you know, and I really, in principle at least, I think everyone should be Christian, but bomb, bomb, bomb. Armed to the teeth, Christian.
But Dwight's not like many other Christians in Orange County. He's a Catholic worker, part of a social justice movement which emphasizes doing the work of Christ. No one can say exactly who is and who isn't doing God's work in Orange County, says Dwight. because Jesus makes his words available for anyone to interpret. He's more concerned about a larger problem of churchgoers merely going through the motions of religious tradition.
A lot of times people just kind of coast. They go to church on Sunday maybe, or they go to church on holidays, but they don't do a lot of serious thinking about, I suppose, what God wants of them. Certainly not what Christ wants of them. And I kind of think that they're sidestepping the question. Certainly never, not even in Catholicism, which is adamant about the fact that we have to do something. And that's a primary difference in the tenets of Catholicism and Protestantism as I know it, and that Catholicism expressly teaches that if you do not perform the corporal works of mercy, you will go to hell. In other words, that you can't just believe that Jesus is your Savior, you have to act like it. And there are seven specific ways they want you to act like it if you're a layperson. They include feeding hungry people, giving them something to drink, clothing them when they're naked or ill-clothed, housing them when they're homeless, which is the bugaboo, visiting them when they're sick and imprisoned, and burying them when they're dead. And these are the tasks that we're to undertake in the effort to sanctify the world. And we believe that lay people are responsible for the sanctification of the world, the holiness of the world. And that's going to happen when everybody has enough to eat, when everybody has a house, when everybody has clothes. And it's not going to happen until then. You know, the temple stands unfinished until all are housed and in dignity.
Coming up on part two of Left, Right, and Christian. It's not just liberal Catholics who are feeding Orange County's poor population. Christian conservatives are doing it too.
We have beans and rice, we have drinks, we have condiments, vegetables, meat and soup.
As they attempt to heal gays and lesbians.
Our church would not marry two lesbians, nor two gay guys. So our goal is to try to love them into making the choices that we believe the scripture says.
And call for the union of Christianity and American politics.
We have a very proven record of basing our country's beliefs on a greater power, and that being God.
That's it for this edition of Making Contact. Special thanks to Mike Dunphy, Ronald Rucker, and Dan Turner. Our theme music is by the Charlie Hunter Trio. Making Contact is an independent production funded primarily by generous gifts from people in the community. We are committed to providing a unique forum for voices and opinions not often heard in the mass media. If you'd like to support our work, or if you have ideas for future programs, we'd love to hear from you. For a cassette or CD copy of program number 4405, call the National Radio Project at 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also visit our website at radioproject.org.
Lisa Rudman is our executive director, Tina Rubio, senior producer, Dorian Taylor, communications manager, Esther Mania, outreach coordinator, Tom Evans, development associate, Emily Polk, production fellow, and Megan Kaiser, production intern. I'm Pauline Bartoloni.
And I'm Justin Beck. Thanks for listening to Making Contact.
Join Dr. Cornel West and Berkeley native Imam Zaid Shakir as they discuss Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X in Martin and Malcolm, Implications of Their Legacies for the Future, on Friday, December 2nd, from 8 to 11 p.m. in the Calvin Simmons Theater of the Henry J. Kaiser Convention Center, located at number 10, 10th Street in Oakland. Tickets are $20 regular and $10 for students. Proceeds go to the nonprofit organization New Islamic Directions. Call 510-238-7765 or visit newislamicdirections.com for tickets or information. Doors open at 6:30 p.m.